Hey everyone, welcome to Ian and Friends Tour de Suisse Edition. I am FloBikes Senior Editor Ian Dille.
And I am Michael Sheehan, Ian's friend. Today we are going to talk about stage 5 of the Tour de Suisse. And, you know, gotta give credit to my dear friend Ian here. He really hit the nail on the head with a couple predictions yesterday.
I am super smart. I also talked to Larry Warbasse before the start of the Tour de Suisse, and he told me that he was going to be looking for the breakaway in the mountain stages. So I did say that Larry was going to be in the break today, but Larry also kind of told me he was going to be in the break today.
You nailed it. Nailed it, man. Good job.
And he smashed it. He was so good. I mean, there weren't a lot of other climbers in the break, but they got to the second climb of the day, the first beyond category climb, and he just rode away from everybody.
Yeah, in doing so, he netted himself a clean 20 points for taking the HC climb. He is now second overall in the climber's jersey, and that's pretty exciting for us. He did not manage to hold on for the stage, try as he might, but he has a really good shot at going for the KOM jersey throughout the rest of the week. So we are probably going to see a very active Larry Warbasse still to come.
Yeah, he looked resplendent in his Stars and Stripes jersey. He'll be defending that in Nashville next weekend. His descending, let's talk about his bike a little bit. Aqua Blue rides one of the more unique bikes in the Pro Peloton.
Yeah, so they are on a 3T aerodynamic frame. Looks pretty sleek, I'll hand it to them. They have made the very interesting choice to go with a one-by setup, so they only have one big chain ring up front, a very large range cassette in the back, and disc brakes. And Ian has been constantly, I'm just going to go out and say it, Ian has been like hating on it throughout our like group text while we watch the stage. Ian is not impressed.
He smashed it on the descent. That thing was flying downhill. You noted the late braking with the hydro discs. Yes. Larry said it's highly aerodynamic. I didn't even realize this, but apparently the inner chain ring of a bicycle makes it less aerodynamic.
And there's no front derailleur, also yeah. Catches wind.
I'm a little bit concerned about how heavy these bikes are. You know, we're seeing a lot of these disc aero bikes, and I kind of feel like these things have got to be tanks. And when they hit the climb, the final climb, Larry came back pretty quickly. I don't want to blame that entirely on his bicycle, but you never know.
Okay, may have won. It's an interesting setup. I will say, it can't be that heavy. He doesn't have a left shifter button.
That's true, no front derailleur. We don't really cover tech on Flow bikes yet, luckily, so we can...
So we're really just like throwing things in the dark.
we can make these rash takes about bikes. But it's cool too. I mean, they're a pro continental team, and I talked with Larry a little bit about it when we interviewed him, and you know, they're trying out technologies that we could be seeing on everybody's bikes 5 years from now. I mean, I don't think we thought that everybody would be running disc brakes, and now it's becoming more and more common for riders to be running disc brakes. Yep. So
I personally ride disc brakes, love them. One bys, you know, I don't know, the whole dirt knobby tire crowd has gone to one bys pretty much, so maybe we'll see that. They are definitely pioneers in the technology and making it work.
Yeah, let's skip ahead to the finish. BMC, it was not Larry's bike, really. It was BMC. The last 3 days, they have just been going nuts on the front of this field. They haven't really let any breakaway go. I guess Yul Jensen won out of the breakaway yesterday, but that was really thanks to his own determination. And they were smashing it at the base of this climb. Van Avermaet was on the front. TJ Van Garderen was setting it up. And it was really Mikel Landa ended up, you know, blowing out the rest of the BMC team.
Yeah, we saw Movistar starting to look a little bit anxious, and Mikel Landa just shot out of the field like a cannonball. He put in a really good effort. He was really like, it was a tall order when he made that move. He was going into a headwind up the climb, and it just wasn't really a favorable gradient for the pure climbers. You know, you could see the peloton was like, it was reduced, but there were still a lot of people benefiting from a draft. If it had been a steeper finishing climb, Landa probably could have held on to that move, but it just wasn't quite hard enough for the pure climbers. That being said, what he did accomplish was blowing out TJ Van Garderen, who had to just completely sell out for Richie Porte in the final kilometers. So now BMC went from having three riders in the top three to now it's just Richie Porte.
Yeah, and Movistar still has three riders in the top three. They've still got Nairo Quintana.
Three riders in the top 11.
Top 11.
They're there.
Yeah. Andre Amador and Mikel Landa are all still there. So, and they're good at playing the numbers game. One thing we see them doing a lot is sending lower-placed riders up that are still in contention up the road, so they're there to help the GC riders at the end of these stages. So it's something that we might see tomorrow. We'll kind of get into the stage tomorrow and how the tactics might shake out, but Movistar definitely has the numbers advantage.
Yeah, then the finish.
Yeah.
Diego Ulissi, holy cow. Gotta say, first, Enric Mas, that was your pick yesterday, mm-hmm. I do believe. So close, he was locked on Ulissi's wheel, but Diego Ulissi took the front pretty much a minute out from the finish line, and when he went, yeah, nobody could just come around him.
Yeah, there's an old saying, when in doubt, lead out, and Ulissi knew he was the fastest rider in that group. Went to the front with 400 meters to go. We were looking at his watts on Velon. He was doing over 500, 600 watts.
Before he actually started sprinting.
Yeah, he pulled Landa back in, doing around 500 to 600 watts for 30, 40 seconds. And then he sprinted at over 800 watts for 20 seconds. And the guy only weighs 130 pounds. It was just a phenomenal performance at the end there.
Yeah, it was a true show of confidence. He knew that finish. He knew that was very much in his wheelhouse, and all he had to do was just ride as hard as he can, and yeah, nobody would be able to come around him.
Yeah, so in the GC, Porte was there. He ends up in the jersey. I think we were all sort of expecting that Porte would be in the jersey at the end of the day. It'll be interesting to see what BMC does to defend it, how he is able to defend it. This race ends with a time trial, and Porte is definitely one of the strongest time trialists in the top 10, if not the strongest time trialist. So I don't know how concerned they'll be about defending it or just keeping everybody in range, knowing that Porte can win it on the final stage.
Yeah, you know, BMC, they have a very strong team. They are going to be able to defend for Porte, but I think that their big worry is going to be Movistar. You know, the move that we saw today from Landa, if it had been a harder climb, maybe a tailwind, definitely a bit steeper, we probably would have seen Quintana launch across to Landa. Coming days, a lot more climbing to come. We are probably going to see this tactic for Movie start playing out. And yeah, we're going to get a good preview of where Richie Porte's legs are and if he's going to be able to handle that kind of pressure from other teams going into the tour.
Yeah, and let's talk about this stage tomorrow because it's a super interesting stage. Two monster climbs, both above category in the first two-thirds of this race. We have the Furka Pass and then the Clausen Pass, and then there's 70 kilometers and a really sort of interesting, you know, category three climb, but the climb is really comprised of a sort of the middle kilometer that pitches at like 15%. So finally we have some steep pitches in the Tour de Suisse to shake things up a little bit. A lot of the Tour de Suisse has been defined by these kind of long, flat, gradual climbs.
Yeah, you know, it's going to be a stage, like Ian said, two really, really massive mountains early on, and it's so much is just going to depend, I think, on what Movistar wants to do, because they have ostensibly the strongest climbers in the race. BMC, they're going to sit at the front and ride tempo and just try to protect Richie Porte and keep as many lieutenants in the mix as possible for him. If Movistar decides to light it up, it is probably going to get very hard and blown up tomorrow.
Yeah, and if it's, you know, it'll be interesting also, you know, there's going to be a big battle for the breakaway. I think we can expect to see Larry Warbasse going for the break again tomorrow, trying to scoop up those above category King of the Mountain points. But if the breakaway doesn't have a huge gap at the top of the Clausen Pass and the GC battle hasn't really lit up, there's 70 kilometers before the final kick to the line. And at that point, it's going to be a classics rider's day. I mean, I think if Peter Sagan is still in the mix, if Michael Matthews is still in the mix, or within range of chasing back to the lead group, you're going to see Sunweb and Bora going all out to bring the breakaway back before the final climb.
Yeah, lots of different games really at play. You know, we have just so many different rider types in this field. We'll see how it plays out. Please tune in to FloBikes for Tour de Suisse. And we have a few other races going on as well.
Yeah, Tour de Slovenia, the OVO Women's Tour, and the Route de Occitanie. I am totally saying that wrong. But interesting races with other tour contenders in them. Alejandro Valverde, Nibali. So yeah, go to FloBikes, look at our calendar. Lots of interesting races going on besides the Tour de Suisse.
Yeah, check it out. Thanks for joining us.
We'll see you guys tomorrow.